stuck in the procrastination phase, but soon enough, maybe I'll be there. And I'm also a photographer, and I just have like this new Instagram account where I post some pictures I take. So if you guys have Instagram, I kind of really need followers at this moment. So that's the first assignment and the most important one. Please follow me, okay? It's kind of a joke, but seriously, do. All right. I just wanted to start saying thank you to Jared for the invitation. Thank you so much for all the Miami School Board for accepting me to be here, for thinking this is a good idea. I'm not sure if it is, but it's nice. I'm really glad to be here. And I also want to thank Nelly, my really old friend. We know each other for 15 years now. We went to high school together. We went to college together. We had the first job together, and she was the irresponsible one for telling him that I could be here. And thank you, Nelly. Thanks again. Oh, that's nice. So I don't know if you can see, but I'm shaking a lot. But that's normal. I shake. It's not because I'm nervous. I just shake. It's true. So I want to tell you that up ahead that this talk will be divided in three chapters. And I'm not going to tell you what's coming after, because nobody really likes spoilers. So I'll just like start with the first chapter, which is called the good chapter. That's the only good chapter you're gonna see here now. And it's basically, I'll just wanna talk about like where I came from and how did I get at this place where I am right now. So I'm from Brazil. And every time that I say that to people, like in Germany was like this, here it's like that as well. People say, oh, you're from Brazil, that's so nice, you must go to the beach every day, that's so cool. And I'm like, yeah, no, not really. I'm really far away from the beach. I don't know really in miles, but it's like a bunch of miles. It's like 1,100 kilometers from the nearest beach, and that's a lot of miles. So this place where I come from, it's not like a advertising industry pole where everybody wants to go to work in advertising, but that's all I had. I went to college, I studied advertising there, and I don't know if there's more Brazilians here. Is there any more Brazilians here? Besides, yay. Really? You're from my hometown? Jeez, we must be cousins or something like that. That's cool. Okay, so you know that everything that people know about our place is that we are known for the old school country music and the new school country music and girls dressed as cowgirls dancing parties to country music, correct? Kind of. It's a stereotype, but I mean, it's true, you know? But we survived. I mean, I had a rock band there, so it was okay. So starting my career there, at this first agency I worked, it's called AMP, and it was back in 2010, it was kind of like the best agency in Goiânia. And I learned a lot there, like the basics. It was really nice to be there, to be there as a in a first job. But after a while I saw like people, like my friends, leaving Goiânia and going to São Paulo to do Miami at school, because we would watch like case films from Droga 5 and Ogilvy São Paulo or like BBH London, and we were like, man, how can we do this? How can we do this here in Goiânia? Can we do this here in our hometown? And the answer is no, you can't, because our life there was just like making banners and making TV spots in which we just show like a bunch of products and their prices. So we couldn't really like do anything that's exceptionally creative in that place, because it's just like how the local market reacts to advertising. It has to be direct and with no ideas behind it. So I got like, I wanted to go to São Paulo as well, and I wanted to learn how to do this great advertising that I was looking at. And but I was like in a really comfort zone. Like I was in the comfort zone. I had my parents, I lived with my parents, I had a job, was paying me well, but I just needed more. And I wanted to go to a place where I didn't know if it was going to be as good as what I was living. But then I talked to my parents and they were like, okay, we don't really have money, but I mean, you can like find something to, I don't know, like get a freelance, go there and we'll support you the way we can. And I said, cool. And that was like the first lesson I took. That sounds really cheesy and you see that all the time, but it's like, it's incredible truth it is that fuck the comfort zone, you know? You have everything right there, but why would you leave it? I left because I was not happy at the place I was. So I went to Miami at school to learn how to do that crazy advertising that I was in love with. And once I went to Miami at school, this is what happened. So yeah, that was me when I saw what I could do with advertising. And it really blew my mind. I finally understood what concepting is and how you can make like integrated campaigns and how can you do stuff that I never saw myself doing back in my hometown. And that was like super cool, super, super cool. And like as this guy, it blew my mind. So, and I was like really into doing stuff that I didn't know how to do. So this is just like a few of the stuff I did at Miami at school. And I was doing a lot because I wanted to learn everything I could learn from Miami at school. And one case that I'm going to show you guys, it was a briefing from an award show from South America. And but the thing is that the entries should have been made with case films, and I never ever opened a software to cut movies or anything. But I had one idea with my team partner, and the teachers liked that idea as well. But I had to learn how to make a fucking case film, and I never did that, and I was afraid. But in the end, I was like, man, you know what? I have everything in my hands. I have a computer, and I have YouTube. And you can learn how to do anything on YouTube. They have tutorials about every single thing. So I just opened the YouTube and I Googled like what I wanted to do and how, and I searched on how to do that. And I did this case film that gladly gave me some awards. And it's still up to date. It's one of the best ideas I think I had. So I'm gonna show you guys what my first case film looks like.
I know how
Thank you. So what I want to tell you again, the second cheesy thing that I want to tell you guys, is that this is the moment of your life, of your career, that you shouldn't be lazy at all. It took me like 2 weeks to make that. And I did the worst way possible. Like a person that knows how to deal with the softwares, they would have done this, is like, I don't know, one day. It took me 2 weeks. But it was worth it. So it doesn't matter what you have in your mind, you can do it. You'll find a way. And this is not the time to be lazy. Like, this is the time that you have to build your portfolio to show to your future agency. And you can only achieve like really good work when you're not lazy to do the good work. If I was lazy, I wouldn't have done that, and probably I wouldn't have done any case films. But I hate doing case films, actually. But this is something that needs to be done when you're a student, so you can have like a really good portfolio. So the idea is most important. Then you'll find a way to execute it. I'm sure you're going to find a way to execute it. Going on with my life, with the quarters away from my MAD school, I had the opportunity to go to Jungformat, which is in 2011 was kind of like the big, like it was the agency of the year in Cannes, because like they won a bunch of awards with like the Invisible Drive and some other work. So it was highly competitive to go to Jungformat, but it was the only place I could actually go, because they would pay for the housing and I wouldn't have money to go anywhere else. And the principal in my MAD school in São Paulo, he said, well, you can try. I mean, it's going to be difficult, but you can try. So I sent my stuff and they liked it, and they called me to do the quarter away there. They approved me. And after, it was 3 months of internship, then I went to, needless to say, I was in love with Hamburg. Hamburg and Germany is like an amazing place. I really liked, since the beginning, like from day one, I said, I want to work here. And after I finished my MAD school, the same day I finished my MAD school, I got a call from Jungformat again. And they said, well, your intern here, we like you, do you want a job? And I said, sure, man, I want a job. And I went there. And the thing is that as a junior, you might be like in the best agency in the world. It could be like in Droga 5. It could be like, I don't know. It doesn't matter where you are. As a junior, you're going to do shit in the beginning. You're going to do like the worst job that nobody wants to do. And that's true. That's like a really awful but simple truth. But the thing is that at one moment at Jungformat, I saw that people were like acting weird because Vodafone, one of our clients, they wanted to make like a huge campaign with a film and a storytelling film. And nobody would ever imagine that Vodafone would make a storytelling film for TV. Because basically what they always have done was just product and price. And then I saw that people like senior creatives and creative directors, they were working on this briefing to make a new campaign for Vodafone, and they were like going for creativity. And when I saw that, I came to my creative director and said, well, I know I'm doing this banner that nobody will ever watch, but can I work on this brief as well? And they're like, yeah, sure, man. I mean, yeah, you know, there's a competition. Like, there's like 5 senior teams working on that. It's like, well, it doesn't matter. I just wanna be able to show some ideas. And they let me. I mean, they're not going to deny more work, you know. So it's my problem. If I want more work, they're gonna give me more work. And they gave me that. And me and my team partner, we actually had the spot that the client liked the most. And it was really nice for someone that was just like 1 year as a junior to be able to do this film and this campaign with them. So the story is basically about this girl that has a grandfather, and the grandfather is like sick, but he has a bucket list. So using her cell phone to FaceTime and to Skype, she would go and get his bucket list and do every single thing of his bucket list for him so he could feel like he was doing them himself. And that's the film that we did for Informat that time. So this is the best time to do that. And by doing that, sometimes you get to do like a really nice film or a really nice campaign for like the biggest clients in your agency. And I'm really glad that fortunately it happened to me. But now, I told you that this was the good chapter, right? And now we're going to the second chapter of the story, which is a terrible chapter. Okay, so why is it so terrible? I showed you one film that I did at Jungformat, and I produced some other stuff there as well, but nothing that I'm really proud of. But in 1 year or 2 years, how many ideas do you think you have inside an agency, and how many times do you think those ideas die? It happens all the time. So this is a terrible chapter because it's all about frustration. And more than ever, to be a creative, it's not only about having ideas, but it's like, it's to know how to deal with that frustration. Because this is how the industry works. You have like too many no's. You have like a stack of ideas that you present every day to your boss, and he says no, and he says no. But sometimes you're like, but this idea is so good, bro. You have to make this. This is amazing. And they're like, well, you know, I don't think it's good. And sometimes the client doesn't think it's good. I mean, you have to deal with that. And I got hurt so many times. I'm kind of an emotional guy, you know? And when I like something, when I like this idea, I just want to see it happening, but it doesn't happen. So it's too many no's. Like, a lot of ideas will be rejected. There's too much competition as well. Like, they have a brief, but they put like 5 to 6 teams to work in the same brief, and in the end, just one team will be the one that is going to be able to produce that. So it's really frustrating, and the problem is that I don't think that, oh, actually this could be a good idea, so Miami at school could have like a frustration management class, because nobody prepares us for that. Nobody prepared me. So that's the question. So, and that's how the industry works. The point is that we should know how not to take it personally. And that's also like really difficult. But how to deal with that? I was like hating everything at some point because I just couldn't like get my ideas approved for some reasons, like, oh, it doesn't go really well with the briefing, or the creative director doesn't have, like, he doesn't see the brand or the idea as I see it, and you have to deal with that, you have to accept. So my conclusion is that I cannot depend on others to make things happen. And the solution I got for that is that I'll just have to make it myself. And once I realized that was just like, I don't need a fucking brand in the end of my stuff. I can do it and put it on me. That's my work. And that's me, that's what I do, and I don't need a brand to be on top of that. And that's when we go, when we leave the terrible chapter and we enter the awesome chapter. It's really awesome because for me, this is kind of escape. When I can't, when I have an idea that got rejected, but I love it so much that I just want to do it myself. And I think that you guys have heard about this thing before. Personal projects and side projects and all those things. And in a way, that's kind of what motivates me to keep going, because I'm a creative, we're all a creative, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to work for a brand. You can work for yourself. If you have one idea that you truly believe it's unique, just go there and do it, you know? So, for example, you got an idea that was rejected by your teacher or boss, but you still think that this idea like kicks ass, so you should do it anyway. Or you have an idea that you're passionate about, but you don't have the right client or briefing to like to sell it to you. That doesn't mean anything. If the idea is good and you like it, you should do it anyway. Or you have an idea that you love so much, but you're worried because you don't even know how to start doing that. Like me and my case film. I didn't know how to do that, but you always find a way to do those kind of things. And you cannot wait for other people to help you, because sometimes they don't, sometimes they do, you know? So my point is that when you really love an idea, you should pursue it anyway, by any means. So, and personal projects, I think that it allows us the freedom to work on whatever you want and experiment and try something new. So you don't have client demands, you don't have deadlines, and you work as a creative director of yourself, so it's all entirely up to you. So in essence, personal projects, at least for me, it gives me the opportunity to do exactly the kind of work that I want to be doing. And for example, once I had like an interview at Pereira Hotel in San Francisco, and PJ Pereira, the owner, he looked at my book and he was like, he closed the computer and he said, I don't wanna see your work. Everybody can have like a Volkswagen ad. I wanted to know what you do when you're not working. And that just like clicked this thing in my head that this is like really important nowadays. More than your work, also creative directors want to know what you do like for fun or like what kind of person you are and what motivates you, what do you like doing. And just to show that we are creatives, but we're not only creatives for advertising. Even Cannes Lions changed its name. Before it was International Advertising Festival, and now it's just a festival of creativity. So you don't really need a brand to be creative. And even my MA at school got that. So it's Miami at school, of course, but it's more than that now. It's Miami Idea School. So it's all about the idea. It's all about if it's going to be executed or not. Like we all have this pile of ideas that got rejected. And now maybe it's time to revisit some of them. And if you find something that you really like, maybe just do it, you know? So I wanna support everything that I said right now with this case. Of a piece of work of mine that got rejected 3 times by creative directors. And I was like, man, I'll try to do this myself and let's see what happens. So just a background story for that. I was at Jungformat, my first agency in Germany, and they had a client called Edeka. The Germans around here know what Edeka is. It's a supermarket chain. The best place where you can find fresh food and all sorts of food and have like many options on whatever kind of food you want to eat, you can find it there and good quality. So I had this idea and I presented just like this, as you can see. This is a screen grab I took from 2012, I guess, or 2012, 2013. I'm sorry, it's in German. Oh, you can't really see shit. Okay. But the idea is So if Edeka has all these kind of foods for any kind of taste, let's make a cookbook about pregnancy cravings. Because I know that pregnant women, sometimes they want to eat the weirdest shit. And I had like stories, and I knew this girl I had, even before I showed this idea. Actually, this girl was the one that told me that she had this weird pregnancy craving. And I thought of her when I was thinking about this idea. And she told me that when she was pregnant of her first child, she had this craving of eating Oreo biscuits with toothpaste. Oh, yeah, oh my God. It's like, that's insane. And is it even good? And she was like, well, by the time it was really good. Then I got my baby and I tried to eat it again. It was just terrible. Make me puke everything. But this is stuck in my head in a way that this is something really interesting. And I didn't see any brand or anybody doing anything about pregnancy cravings. So I thought it would be like, this is a perfect chance to do something for the supermarket that is original and use their food in a fun way, you know? Then I showed it to my boss, and it was a really quick meeting, actually. He saw the idea, it's like, no, I have to go now. And I was like, but do you even understand what I want to say? Yeah, no, I understand, but no, I really have to go. I was like, okay, fine. And back in that time, I didn't find the solution of how to deal with this frustration. I didn't tell myself, like, I'm going to do it myself. So I just, like, kept the idea in my stash of dead ideas. And when I went to my next agency, which was DDB Hamburg, I saw that they also had a supermarket client. And I was like, well, you know, like, everybody does that. Let me show this idea again, but I'm not going to show just like written down. I'm going to make a board and show it. A board will change everything. So I just like felt like this guy. And I was like, okay, I'm going to show it again. So this time I made a board and I thought it was like amazing. It's not even really good, man. But it shows that it's a pregnancy cookbook. Like a craving cookbook, you can see like a pickles with chocolate, which is not really a craving because, as you're going to know soon enough, I studied a lot about pregnancy cravings for the years to come. And I presented to my boss, and he was like, oh, that's really interesting. That's really nice, but no. It's not going to work with this client. They just want to sell stuff, you know, like, it's interesting, I see where you're going there, but it's just not gonna happen. And at this time, when I was like, I already had made some personal projects before at this time, and I was like, you know what? This guy appeared again, and I'm going to do this myself. I'm going to make this shit myself. So I told my girlfriend about this idea, and she loved it, and she was like, man, and she actually made it even cooler. She was like, maybe it's not a cookbook because, bro, how are we going to publish a book? So maybe we start with a website, and then we find those real cravings, and then we eat every one of them, and we write reviews. She's a copywriter. And I was like, oh, you're going to write reviews. You're going to eat all this shit and write reviews. It's like, no, I'm not going to do it alone. You're going to eat too. So you can have like a review, like a balance. We can like, if I gave 5 stars for one, you give 1, then we have like 3. It's like, okay, fine. So we eat all of them. But then we thought, okay, I know how to take pictures. I have a camera, I have a tripod. She has a white table. She has like a lamp. And she knows how to cook. I didn't know how to cook back then. So we have almost everything. We don't have someone to do the food styling because we wanted it to look like a gourmet kind of cookbook. And this guy appeared again, and we started to send emails to all the food stylists we could find in Hamburg and Berlin. Guess how many of those guys answered? 1. But as soon as she knew that there was no money involved, she stopped answering the email. because we were like, we were telling up front, this is like a personal project. It's for our portfolios. Maybe you're building your portfolio and you have like something really unique and original kind of pictures in your food stylist portfolio. Maybe you want to work and collaborate with us. But yeah, I mean, it's really difficult to find people to collaborate when there's no money involved. So I was still passionate about the idea. My girlfriend was as well. So for the last time, this guy, he was like, man, you're an art director. You know basic design. You know like balance, symmetry, negative space, colors. You can do it yourself, maybe. And then that's just clicked. I mean, like, I had nothing to lose at this moment. I had one idea that I really like. And I had like me and my girlfriend that wanted to do that. So I was like, Vicky, you're gonna cook, I'm gonna take a picture, and we do the food styling together, and then we try the shit, and then if we puke, we puke, if we don't, we just write the review. But, all right. So that was all I needed. It's just like a confidence that I could do it. And then we started taking those pictures. This is the Oreos and toothpaste, the first picture we took. I have to tell you, it's quite good. It's not bad at all. I mean, you shouldn't eat a bunch of them, but it's not really bad. And then we made sure that all the recipes we had in this website would be real recipes, would be real pregnancy cravings. We just didn't want to like come up with something. We wanted it to be true since the beginning. So I talked to a bunch of people. She talked to a bunch of people. We went to like forums online to find girls that say like, oh, I had this burger with Mars bars, candy, and bacon when I was pregnant. And then we would just like target this person, reply her comments, and then like ask her if she could like tell us more about this. And in the end, after we couldn't wait anymore to keep doing this, and we had like 15 pictures and stories for the website. So this was the first picture we took. This was the second one, which is orange with tomato sauce. I don't recommend this at all. The other one I recommend, but this one's just too bad. You just want to kill yourself after this. And then we had like a chocolate cake with olives. And we made the chocolate cake, we made everything. And then we had, I don't know what's the name in English, but sauerkraut. It's like cabbage stuff with popcorn. And it's not any worse than just sauerkraut itself. So you know how it is. And then after taking those pictures, we had like 16 pictures where we uploaded to this website, and they call it Eating for Two, the Pregnancy Cravings Cookbook. And after it was online, it was crazy the positive response we had from the media in general. Like we had, oh, sorry, before that, I want to show like some kind of how it looks like. So this is a simple content where you have like bacon and Mars bar burger, and you have 4 stars. And you have like the review saying, it's pretty crazy, but the good kind, not the one that runs after you in a mask with a chainsaw. And another one would be the choc olive cake. It's the perfect birthday cake for your enemies because it's really bad. Those things just don't go well together at all. And then we explain how to make it, like the ingredients, the step-by-step and everything. And just one more. It's the sausage and jam. And everybody that listens to that, they are like, oh, that kind of sounds good. But we also thought that, and we had high hopes for this one, so you could say that this is what disappointment tastes like. And it's really bad, too. But I mean, you have to understand, like, the thing about pregnancy cravings is that, like, their body lacks some nutrients. So whatever that has a lot of those nutrients, they're just, like, attracted to those things. And then we have like all these blogs like Mashable and Huffington Post, Daily Mail, Trend Hunter, Taxi, Foobies, they're all like sharing this thing that when I presented to my bosses, nobody gave a fuck about. But these guys, like it was, these are like the most well-known ones, but we had like hundreds of websites sharing this content. And we had like, I don't know how many thousands access in our website. And those are a few quotes from this website. So they say, Huffington Post said, it's the ultimate book for expectant mothers. Pop Sugar said, this gourmet pregnancy craving cookbook is the most hysterical book ever. And Parents said, the book is not yet available, but stay tuned if you dare. And at this moment, we didn't have any intention to turn it into a book, because it was so difficult to find like 15 recipes. But it got a publishing house interested in that. And they called us and they said, do you want to make a book with us? And I said, fuck yeah, let's make it a book. And they said, well, you just need like 50 more. You need like 65 recipes. And it was like, we didn't know if we could do that. How are we going to find 65 recipes? And as you can see, the name of the book is different. It's Pickles and Ice Cream now, because of reasons. And we just like embraced the challenge, and we started like talking to everybody about like if they knew someone that was pregnant. We went to all these mom Facebook groups. We asked people, and in the end, we were able to find 70 recipes. So this book will be published in 2 months, and it will have 70 recipes on them. And this is just like how it kind of looks like. A few pages. This is just like onions, raw onions. A flower salad. It's really good. Really pretty, at least. So when I see stuff like that, I'm kind of impressed with myself. I was like, man, I don't know. I never did food styling before. And now I can do that. And me and Vicky, we were able to make a book out of an idea that got rejected 3 times. So this first picture on the left is just like a compilation of all the recipes we have, and this is kind of what the book will look like. And we had another idea, just to complement, when the book will be published, we shot 5 couples eating those pregnancy cravings. So we cooked for them and we gave them to eat and we recorded their reaction. We have like 4 hours of material that I still need to cut. That's me cutting the video again. But I just wanted to show you a little bit of one of them. I'm not even sure if it's the funniest part of everything we have. It's just like something that I just randomly choose something. And what they are going to taste in this video, they don't know that. We didn't want to tell them. For the reason, you're going to understand why. So this is actually, it's a smoothie made of coffee, pickles, hot dog buns, and hot dog sausage. And believe it or not, it's real. Like this woman, she wanted to do that. It started. She was just like dipping her hot dog in the coffee and eating. But then she had this crazy, this beautiful idea of like blending everything together. And I have to tell you that we tasted all of those things. This one for me is the champion of like the most disgusting thing I've ever put in my mouth in my entire life. And we did that for them. We make like the plate look so nice for them. Well, they didn't see what was coming, so let's just watch it.
Ready? 1, 2, 3. Oh, I smell coffee.
Why is there going to be poop?
Why is there? Why are there pickles?
It's a little weird. How are you going to go about this?
Okay, so there's pickles on the side and coffee.
There's definitely
and then some.
Is this pickled
coffee?
Wieners?
It's wieners. Coffee wieners. I did not order this.
Wait. Can I send this back?
How come mine is so much more than yours?
This is our new shake.
Okay. But we don't even know what it is. It's just drink it. All right. One, two, three.
Ah. You guys.
Guys, I don't. That was mean.
Now you're mean, just messing with us.
No one drinks that on purpose.
There's no, but. And nobody was ever in the room in front of their, like, blender and was like, here's some coffee. The texture. The texture is what.
Yeah, it's like frothy. It's not a shake. It's not liquid.
It's that like was like sucking up cottage cheese.
It was like a meat shake.
And that's it. Thank you very much for being here. I really appreciate it. Thanks a lot.